Good morning and welcome to Wild Rose United Church. It's the first day of November and it was really nice to see all the kids out last night enjoying Halloween in a slightly different but fun fashion. I had my usual four kids, but I know the neighbors up the street that put out this coolest outdoor display had probably at least a couple hundred. So it was nice that the weather cooperated and we have a beautiful sunny day, and I hope everybody enjoyed that extra hour of sleep that they got last night. And for those that forgot, well, I hope you enjoyed getting somewhere an hour early this morning. So before we get going with the regular part of our service, it is my pleasure to welcome today our new minister, Murray Speer. It's his first Sunday with us. He's going to do the sermon later. But we have a little welcome gift for him this morning. So I'm going to call up Dora and Judy. We're going to have to stay masked, ladies, because we're going to be a little close, as we have a little presentation for Murray and his family. This is gonna be a little awkward. Would you like us to go out in the middle and you can pan the camera? Yeah. So we're gonna walk slowly. It's kind of... Welcome to the challenges of live streaming technology when we surprised Dawn with something that we hadn't pre-planned. But you must have a sense of humor to work in a church. You have to. Okay, so we have a lovely gift basket here. We're going to call it the Preacher's Pandemic Kit. It contains stuff for the adults and the kids. There are 19 chocolates to symbolize COVID-19. One bottle of red wine, one bottle of white wine. This is the United Church. We'll get away with that. There are soap, hand sanitizer. There is some Calangari snacks and some lovely homemade masks, which I think you need to take a look at right now. With some Baby Yoda and various other things on, made by Judy there. A little card for each of you. And then also, because, you know, don't like the, there's some fairly adult stuff in there. We don't want the kids to be left out. So, an Avengers throw for Finn. And for the new baby to come, because I do not know gender, a gender neutral baby blanket. So this is for you and your family. Welcome to Wild Rose. We can't do covenanting services yet. This is something we'll have to figure out down the road. So in the meantime, please accept these gifts and welcome to Wild Rose.
I'll say something about this later on, but thank you. This is wonderful, and I know everyone else will be very excited too.
Everybody needs a little something to help get through them through this time. So, and also too, Murray will be organizing and running the services from this day forward. So he's still gonna need volunteers to come out. I have volunteers lined up for next week, but anyone who wants to come and read scripture, light candles, help say prayers, or whatever Murray needs, please let Joanne in the office know so that Murray has a nice pool of people to call upon. And it's a way for him to get to know people in the congregation a few at a time. As we gather, we take this opportunity to acknowledge the traditional territories of the people of the Treaty 7 region in southern Alberta, which includes the Blackfoot Confederacy, comprising the Siksika, Piikani, and Kainai First Nations, as well as the Tsuut'ina First Nation and the Stoney Nakoda, including the Chiniki, Bearspaw, and Wesley First Nations. The city of Calgary is also home to Métis Nation of Alberta, Region 3. Wild Rose is a safe place for all people to worship, regardless of race, creed, age, cultural background, or sexual orientation. All are welcome here. I'd like to now call Judy Bergeson up to help with the lighting of the Christ candle.
As this candle is lit, some of us are watching the flame dance in the sanctuary, while others are watching using computer and phone screens. Wherever you are, may the light and warmth of Christ, this candle represents, reach out to you. May that light and Christ's love bless you this day and stay with you in your heart for many days to come. And now for the call to worship. Please join in on the words written in bold. Come to this place to hear the stories of God's people. We come in keen anticipation. Come to this place to sing the songs that tell of Christ's love for God's people. We come with open hearts. Come to this place to witness the beauty created by the Holy Spirit working among God's people.
We come ready to hear the Spirit's call in our lives.
We come to worship God. Oh, this is me too. Our opening prayer this morning. Gracious God, as we gather here on this Sunday morning, we are enjoying the warmer weather that has come our way this week to melt the snow and brighten our days. Some of us are anxious and stressed, while others are finding some daily joys. May your Spirit wash over us this morning and help our minds and hearts be healed and strengthened as we continue on this journey through life together, guided by your grace. Amen.
Thank you, Judy. Now let's get our singing voices warmed up as we sing Jesus Christ is Waiting, Voices United number 117. As always, the words will be on the screen. And now Dora is going to read a book for us this morning by Peter Reynolds, So Few of Me.
So yes, the title of this book is So Few of Me, and it's written by Peter Reynolds. Leo was a busy lad. No matter how hard he worked, there was always, always more work to do. Maybe making a list would help. Leo's list of things to do grew and grew. Oh, so few of me and so much to do. If only there were two of me. Just then, there was a knock on the door. Leo opened the door and blinked and rubbed his eyes. It was another him. The new Leo grabbed the list and said, "Two of us will get it done." He was helpful, but found even more to do. A third Leo joined in. How about four? Four makes a fantastic team. But maybe a fifth would be even better. Still not enough. A sixth came in to help organize the lot. After meeting for hours, they decided they needed a seventh. With seven Leos, there was seven times as much work. Leo sighed and said, "Well, we'll need eight just to catch our breath." The eighth Leos worked furiously. Maybe nine Leos would get it done. Look at all the things they're doing. Raking and sweeping and taking the dog for a walk, washing a cat. I'm sure he loved that. Nope. Add one more to make 10. Each one busier than the next. Oh my goodness, look at all the things they're doing. Very busy. Leo, 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 and Leo paused to review their list. "Back to work," the ninth Leo shouted. "No time to stop, no time to rest." But Leo himself was exhausted. He slipped away to take a nap. Oh, we love those naps. Leo awoke to nine other Leos staring at him. "What were you doing?" they demanded. "I was dreaming," he said softly. "Dreaming's not on the list," they roared. Leo smiled, still savoring his dream. The Leos disappeared. They disappeared one by one. Leo wondered, "What if I did less, but did my best?" Then one Leo is all I need, just me, just one, with time to dream. The end. I hope you all had a great Halloween.
I call Claude up to read the scripture.
There are two scriptures this morning. The first one is from Jeremiah, chapter 1, verses 4 to 10. "Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, 'Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations.' Then I said, 'Ah, Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, but I am only a boy.' But the Lord said to me, 'Do not say I am only a boy, for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you.
Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and to pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant. Jesus heals a crippled woman. Now he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and just then there appeared a woman with a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. She was bent over and was quite unable to stand up straight. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said, woman, you are set free from your ailment. When he laid his hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, there are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be cured, and not on the Sabbath day. But the Lord answered him and said, you hypocrites! Does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox and his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? And ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 long years, be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day? When he said this, all his opponents were put to shame, and the entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that he was doing.
So now as Murray moves over to his position, I can just say I am delighted to have him here this morning and happy to turn over the reins to a professional. We've enjoyed his recorded messages, but now we get the live and in person. And welcome, Murray Speer.
It's strange not knowing who's out there. For the last few months, I've been preaching on Zoom almost every Sunday, and on Zoom, I can log in on my phone and I can look and see who else is logged in, and I can say hello to them by name, and I know how many there are. And what makes this even more different is I believe this is going to continue to be available on YouTube. So even if only 10 people are out there today, there might be 1,000 people within a year from now who will have watched this. So one of the things I was trained to do is to shape my remarks to my best perception of who is listening. And this is one of the strange aspects of pandemic time for those of us who are preachers, is we don't know who is listening. So if I happen to shape my remarks in a way that isn't speaking to you, I hope you'll forgive me. My first ever time preaching in a congregation was in April of 2005, and it was the spring time change. It was in April because this was back when daylight time only lasted 6 months. My second time preaching in a congregation was the following October in the same congregation on the next time change weekend. And so it occurred to me back then, 15 years ago, that this was a very smart preacher to have a student come in and do the service on the time change weekend so that she could be off doing other things. I have yet to implement that policy in my own ministries, but at any rate, it wouldn't have been today. I'm trying to eat up a little bit of time for people who came early and then realized that they were an hour early because of the time change, and then went off to do other things, and are now coming back. Jesus heals a bent over woman. A woman who had been inflicted for 18 years. I found myself thinking in the last day or two about a recording by the comedic actor and writer Bruce McCullough, good Alberta boy, part of the Kids in the Hall comedy troupe, for those of us who were around in the 90s and can remember that. And he has a spoken word recording about his experience of being in Seattle on the night of the citywide vigil following the death of Kurt Cobain. And the reason this recording came to me is because Bruce says a line that has stuck with me. It's a line that probably runs through my head at least once a month. Bruce is talking about his experience of being in Seattle at that time and the fact that he had never attended a vigil. He still doesn't. He doesn't go, but he's there for the energy of the city that surrounded that event. And in his reflection on having never experienced a vigil of any kind, he uses the line, and this is the line that I think of probably at least once a month. He says, "We all go through life scathed and unscathed in our different ways." I'm not even sure scathed is a word. But if it isn't, then Bruce has made it one for me. He uses the example. He says, even though he has never been to a vigil, he has owned 4 Toyotas that were in a total of 11 crashes. That's his example. Of how we go through life, each of us scathed and unscathed in different ways. Some of our scathing, some of our experiences that have left their mark on us are visible. Like the woman bent over for 18 years, it is impossible to conceal some of our experiences. What you may not be able to tell from looking at me is that thinking about this woman is I very likely have the same condition that she would have had. The condition that bends a person over is called, it's got a fancy Greek medical name, it's called ankylosing spondylitis. It means inflammation of the spine that causes it to harden. That's what the name means. And some people, if they are unfortunate, if the disease progresses quickly enough, and if it happens in this way, they get pulled over forward into the shape of a question mark. I have that condition, but it's not progressing so quickly for me, and if it progresses for me anything like it did for my father, who I inherited it from, he has the opposite condition to question mark spine. He has bamboo spine. His spine is completely immobile, but completely aligned. His condition is so much less visible. but it creates some interesting obstacles, like if he gets into a normal-sized car, he then cannot reach back out the car door to grab the handle to close the door because his head hits the roof of the car and he can't reach his arm far enough. That's why he loved having a convertible for a while, because he could use his remote to open the roof of the convertible, climb into the driver's seat, and then close the roof back onto himself. Some of our scathings are visible and some are not. We may also have a problem with this story when we hear about Jesus saying to this woman, this daughter of Abraham, woman, you are healed, stand up. And she straightens up immediately. Some of us who have a medical understanding of disease, who have an understanding of specific, particularly these types of diseases, these types of autoimmune diseases and genetic disorders, things that are happening on a cellular level, even on a subcellular level, on the level of DNA, on the level of strings of amino acids that aren't even a cell. And we say, can Jesus really reverse all of that with a word? It's important to talk about that, because when we open up Scripture, when we find obstacles, it can be easy to tell ourselves that it's a yes or no option, that we either have to accept wholeheartedly that Jesus is capable of that, or we have to turn away and set the Bible down. So it's important to come to terms in moments like that. Can Jesus really reverse with a word things that are happening at the cellular and the subcellular level? Well, I can't really answer that question for you. After all, if you have an answer to that question for yourself, I'm not going to change your mind. And if you don't have an answer for it, I can't give you your answer. I can give you my answer, which is, I'm not convinced Jesus could do that. But I can tell you something else. When the person we call Luke was writing these words, it would have been generally accepted that such a thing was possible, that such a thing hypothetically was within the realm of possibility. There may have been people who said, well, Jesus didn't do that, or Jesus couldn't do that, but if you sat them down and asked them, do you think hypothetically someone potentially could? Most of them wouldn't have had a problem with that. Which means if we let ourselves get caught up in the question of whether Jesus can or cannot do that, we run the risk of missing the point. The point that is more about the events surrounding the healing. The events that took place in that synagogue before and after that woman straightened up. There's an interesting translation issue in verse 11 of this story. I'm not sure, I meant to find out beforehand, I'm not sure what translation we used, and I didn't check or confirm or even ask. But I'll find out. Oh, the NRSV? It's a good one. It's a great translation. But in my perspective, it does a little bit of a disservice to verse 11. What we heard Claude read for us was that the woman had been crippled by a spirit for 18 years. Now, that's consistent with a lot of English translations of that verse. But the translation issue is the question of the relationship between those words, the word crippled and the word spirit. Is she being crippled by a spirit? Is she being impaired by a demon? Is she being bent over by a wicked influence? Or does she have, and this is my translation, and there are others that are like it, does she have a spirit of disability? My experiences of disability run deeper than my spine. I also have a sensory processing disorder. Right now, I am wearing dark gray contact lenses covering my entire pupil and iris. Other times, you may see me wearing dark gray glasses. Or in the past, brown glasses, because my color needs changed. I had this sensory processing disorder my whole life, but I wasn't diagnosed until age 28. My entire life, I convinced myself that I wasn't a good student. I convinced myself that I wasn't interested in the lessons I was being taught, that I had other interests, other priorities. And because I still achieved at a high level, even though I was achieving below my potential, we never looked deeper into what I was experiencing. But at age 28, when I realized, when I got the lenses that helped me, the way I would explain it to a five-year-old is I say, I see everything too much. And when I got the lenses, they helped me sort out what I was trying to see. When I realized what my life could have been like if I had been diagnosed 10 or 15 or 20 years sooner, I was overcome by a spirit of disability. I was no more impaired than I had been. In fact, I was less impaired because I had supports and treatment. I was no more in pain. In fact, I understood my pain in a way that I hadn't before. But the grief and the confusion at having to reassess my entire life story, my entire self-image, made me disabled. One of my professors, when I was doing seminary, did work on the theology of disability. The theology of disabled persons in the sense of what can the experience of being differently embodied or neurodivergent teach us about God and about faith. And she pointed out quite rightly that we in the 21st century have a problem that makes scripture stories like the one from today almost inaccessible to us. And that problem is that for as long as we have been alive, there have been advanced surgical techniques to help differently bodied people seem more like the rest of us. And for several generations or centuries before that in Western society, we had institutions where differently bodied people could be sent to live out of the sight of the rest of us. And we had what are called circus sideshows, where differently bodied people could make a living by putting themselves on display. As freaks. But that when we are talking about ancient times, when we are doing theology, when we're relating to the Bible, when we're relating to both the Old Testament and the New Testament, none of that existed. So, if you tune in to a medical oddities TV show, like in my household, we like to watch Dr. Pimple Popper. She deals with skin ailments. And we like to watch one on the same channel called My Feet Are Killing Me, which follows podiatry. You will see people with enormous benign tumors hanging off of their faces. You will see people with 1,000 fatty lumps accumulated under their skin, just making them extraordinarily lumpy. You will see people on the podiatry show who were born with feet that divided in two. Most of them had surgery as children to bring it together. People who were born with more than five toes, people who were born with less than five toes. Any of those programs will show you people who we have become accustomed to setting aside or using advanced medicine to make them look more like the rest of us. And the advanced medicine, to be sure, also helps them, helps people live a more productive and less painful life. But we have allowed ourselves to believe that there is a normal way to have a body, and there are abnormal ways to have a body. And that would not have been the case. Every time you see someone on those programs with a benign tumor hanging off of their nose, imagine that in the ancient world, they would have had no alternative except to go about their business with an enormous benign tumor hanging off their nose. Someone born with a limb difference would have had no alternative but to go about their business with a limb difference. There was no normal body. So, when a woman who is bent over with a spirit of disability is told by Jesus that she is healed, are we to understand that she has gone from having an abnormal body to having a quote-unquote normal body? I can tell you for the last 10 years, I have been working on how I stand and how I walk to deal with back pain, to deal with other issues. I'm light sensitive, and so when I would go outside, I would constantly walk with my forehead pointed down so that I would be getting less light. No one ever taught me how to walk. I remember realizing a few years ago that when people say my feet went out from under me on the ice, they mean that normally their feet are directly under them. That was not how I was ever taught to stand or walk. Now I stand on the balls of my feet, and I walk on the balls of my feet instead of on my heels. And if my disability were visible, if I were inflicted with something that caused people to question me and judge me every time they looked at me, can you imagine how my posture would change then? If I were already hunched over from some medical condition, but I were also being trodden down by the pressures and the judgment of the people around me, by their questions of how this had happened, if I was guilty of sin that made me so bent over, if I had potentially something they could catch from me. And Jesus said, stand up. Would I need to stand all the way up? Or might I simply lift my shoulders a bit? Might I simply let the weight come off my face? Might I simply be relieved of the pressure that had been put on me by a spirit of disability? I was going to talk a lot more about in my original plan, about the experience of coming in new to a new group of people, meeting the people who are here today, receiving these wonderful gifts that I know will be appreciated and enjoyed in our family. I was going to talk more in my original plan about getting to know all of you, about finding out about you, about leadership among you. But suffice to say this, I look forward to finding out the ways in which you have all been scathed and unscathed. Finding out the ways in which you are bent out of shape. Finding out the ways in which I am bent out of shape that might cause us to bump into each other. Finding out the ways that you have needs that up till now I have not been equipped to meet. Finding out the ways I might have gifts and skills to offer that you have not even known were missing. And together, as we learn what has bent us out of shape, I hope that we will greet one another, always, with a spirit that says, stand up and shine, for today we are healed. Amen.
Thank you, Marie. I was really looking forward to hearing your message today, and I gotta admit, spirit of disability, that's gonna stick with me for a while. Also finding myself standing up particularly straight right now. Get my shoulders back. It is wonderful to have you here, and I'm looking forward to hearing many more messages, and I'm also letting people know they get a break from me next week. I hear the cheering over the internet. But for now, let's pray. Dear Lord, I paused to watch the news this morning, as I know there's been a lot going on in the world in the past week. And I was shocked to see how much more I had missed by not watching one newscast. I pray for the people in Turkey after the devastation of the earthquake and tsunami, and all the efforts the relief and rescue workers are doing there. Pray for the people in France who, after having a knife attack, then experienced a shooting in a church in Lyon. Quebec City, where some troubled individual in a medieval costume decided to go around and do a little damage with a blade-like weapon. And I watched the weather and I saw that tropical storm Ida in the Atlantic, a typhoon heading for the Philippines, seeing more COVID cases, the numbers going up worldwide, and seeing lockdowns happening in the UK and across Europe. A gas pipeline explosion in southern Iraq. And then, of course, the ongoing news coverage of the US election and the civil unrest there. News of COVID outbreaks, again here affecting, in particular, one care facility that my mother is actually in, as people have been asking. And the Calgary Correctional Center, where apparently 65% of the inmates have been infected. And then the odd little side story of Sean Connery passing away at the age of 90, sort of beloved Scottish icon. It was tough to watch the news last night and this morning. But every time I look out in the world, I'm reminded of all of the people who are working so hard to help those who are injured, to help the people of those who have lost loved ones, just to help everybody get through their daily lives. The first responders, the rescue workers, the essential workers, volunteers worldwide who do everything they can to try and brighten and lighten the load for others around them. This is a tough time for everybody. So I pray for strength for all of us. And I want to share a little prayer that our own beloved Sam Sparrow sent in. Dear Lord, teacher, mentor, you taught us, we learned. You comfort us, we feel relief. You encouraged us, we found a purpose to keep going. We are always learning. You are always teaching. We thank you for everything to keep us safe with your steadfast support and sound mind, body, and spirit. Sam has a way with words. I pray for him and all the members of our congregation and all of those in our community and around the world who are in need of strength and healing this morning. And now let us say together the words that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Of course, one of the ways that we reach out and help the world is by caring and sharing through our gifts. So as you see on the screen, please consider a donation to Wild Rose United Church to help us continue our ministry to those around us. There's details there about mailing a check or sending an e-transfer or visiting our website to access links to PayPal or Canada Helps. As I've said many times before, every little bit helps. There's a lot of people out there that need our help right now, so whatever you can, please give. Through the many diverse gifts we are given, may we use all that we are and all that we have to grow acceptance, mercy, and love in the world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And now everybody else gets to sing too. Another oldie moldy favorite, as I like to say, getting Dan on the organ for Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing, Voices United 326. But as always, the words will be on the screen.
Jesus.
Thank you. It's always nice to have Claude in the sanctuary singing along with me. So before I send you on your merry way, or actually say a few words before Dan plays again, again, welcome, Murray. I'm really looking forward to this new relationship we have. And I confess that there was a little bit of an agenda to having Dora read that particular book today. And I threw that little message in. Remember to come volunteer. Come be part of these services. You'd be amazed at how much it makes it feel a bit like church. You see a few familiar faces, and you can meet the new minister. Today marks the first day of our journey here at Wild Rose United with our new minister. I realize that many of our ministry teams aren't doing their usual work right now, and we aren't worshiping in the usual fashion. However, I hope many of you take this opportunity to find new ways to get involved with the life and work of our church and get to know our new minister firsthand. As I've said for many weeks, come and take part in the service here on Sunday mornings. You will be amazed at how much comfort just being in this building with familiar faces can bring. It can make you feel more connected to the church community. You don't have to do much, just what you can. As Leo said in the book Dora read today, what if I did less but did my best? I leave that with you as food for thought this week to apply to your connection to this church and other aspects of your daily lives. Amen.